to the newborn King, to the newborn King, King of heaven, come down, King of heaven, come now, let your glory reign, shining like the day, King of heaven, come. Of heaven, rise up. Who could stand against us? You are strong to save in your mighty name. King of heaven, come. King of heaven, come down. King of heaven, come now. Let your glory reign, shining like the day, King of heaven come.
Amen. Let's stand and worship together this morning on Christmas Eve, celebrate the birth of our Savior.
Let's pray. Dear God, we've come to you to bring you all of the honor and praise. God, we thank you that as the world is celebrating this holiday, we come to you knowing the true reason that we celebrate Christmas and knowing that you came not only as a baby 2,000 years ago, but we await with eager anticipation for the day where you come back. The sky is open and the trumpet sounds, and we will live and worship you in the new heaven and the new earth forever. So today we bring you our Christmas offering of praise. Amen.
A Bethlehem appeared a star, while angels sang to lowly shepherds. Three wise men seeking truth traveled from afar, hoping to find the child from heaven, falling on their knees. Before the humble Prince of Peace, the sun cannot compare to the glory of your love. There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne, before the Holy One of heaven. It's only by your blood, it's only through your mercy, Lord, I come. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Bring an offering to you. Over the skies of Bethlehem appeared a star, while angels sang to lowly shepherds. Three wise men seeking truth traveled from afar, hoping to find the child from heaven, and falling on their knees, they bowed before the humble Prince of Peace. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you. I bring an offering to you.
Amen. Lord, thank you for this time that we could worship you. I pray that this is just a part of our offering this morning, our offering of worship, our offering of thanks, our gift to you on Christmas, which is but a small, measly portion in return for the gift that you gave us through your Son, Jesus Christ, that we celebrate. We pray all this. We pray your glory and your kingdom forever. Amen.
There is no junior worship today, no children's church. That's why we call them the busy boxes are out there in the center. If you need some for your children, you can certainly go get one, and they'll join us for Christmas Eve today. So, amen. And I want to lead us in prayer before we move further through the service. Just want to inform you of some things for prayer. One, would you please pray for the Fraley family? I don't know if you remember Samantha Fraley. She joined our church not too long ago. Her daughter, Alice, came up to join and get baptized. Was it last week? The week before? So they're fairly new, but they're going through some family crisis. Her dad has had cancer and went home to be with the Lord. And that happened yesterday. And the good news is, well, there's a lot of good news. It was just a few weeks previous to that I had the privilege to lead him to Christ as he was in a hospital. So he's now with Jesus. So God is a good God. And this amazing story, I may tell you some of it later on. But let's pray for Samantha. She has three other sisters. The wife is named Nancy, and lift them up before the Lord in prayer for comfort and peace and hope. And let's pray for Joshua and Elizabeth Wema, our Ghanaian pastor. He's in Ghana. He went there to be with his sick mother, who did go home to be with Jesus as well. And so he's still there. We don't know exactly when he's coming home because the family's making arrangements. So keep them in prayer. We want to pray for those that are sick. I'm going to miss a lot because there's a lot of sick people in our church are recovering. Mary Champ is recovering from surgery. Chris. And we're thankful that Maureen Perello is now home and recovering at home. That's good news. Jen Hedges is home. She's recovering from home. Craig Cuffey is home, I believe. And he was anyway. I was looking for Pauline. She's counting, I think, so she's not there right now, but pray for her husband. God is good all the time, and he sees us through these things. Maybe there's some things he needs to see you through. Let's just go before him in praise and prayer right now. Heavenly Father, you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We're going to sing that, and we mean it, God, and you mean it. And Father, even as you came as an infant child, you were the creator of the world. Jesus, you existed before time began, and you're in heaven today. And we just rejoice that you came to take on human flesh, become our Savior, and lead us back to you through faith in you, God. Father, what an amazing thing that is. And it still blows my mind every time I think about it. Lord, we thank you that not only that, but you care about every little thing that happens in our lives, and you have a plan for our lives, God. We don't see it. Sometimes we're frustrated because we can't see it, but God, we have faith to trust that you know what it is. And so, Lord, help those who are struggling right now, those that are feeling the loss and grief from a loved one who is passed on. We just pray for them, especially during this Christmas season. Some of us have previous losses that happened in this holiday time, and it just becomes especially more difficult. And we lift them up to you as well. God, thank you for your healing touch on these that have had surgeries and are recovering. We just thank you so much. Thank you for all the ministers of this church, because there are many, God, who serve you, who teach your word, who love children, who do so many things, God, for your glory, who sing songs and lead us to sing songs. Thank you, dear Lord, and be with us today. And open your word to us once again. Father, this is a story that as a Christian we're so familiar with, but Lord, help us to marvel in it once again, because there's no more important truth and story than your story. And be with those who are trying to reach people who have never heard the gospel before. We especially pray for missionaries. And we pray for our part in going to be missionaries, in sending missionaries, in supporting missionaries. God, even as we take this special once a year offering for worldwide missions, Lord, may it just be used in just marvelous ways, and will you accomplish goals all around the world through it this upcoming year. Lord, that's our prayer this morning. We thank you we can pray it. Thank you that you heard it. And we just look forward to you now speaking to us through your word once again. For we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. So I just would like to get you to turn to the Bible. Would you do that? Say, where in the Bible? Well, it's the book of John today. So it's a little different. We're going to be doing something a little different in a moment. I'm going to ask you to stand in a little while and read again. You know, with all the many trappings of Christmas, and man, there's so many trappings of Christmas, and I love them. There's lights, parties, family gatherings, Christmas trees, stars, tinsel, songs, and I could waste a sermon going through them all because there's so many more than that, and on and on and on. There's nothing more central to Christmas for practically everyone on the planet, and especially to children, than gifts. Right? And presents. And it's finally Christmas Eve, tomorrow morning, Christmas morning, and we're just about to do it all over again, right? And it's fun. Children especially, but not just children, teens and adults too, all over the world anxiously look forward to Christmas, to look under the tree, or however they do it in whatever culture they're at, to see what presents they may have received. What child has not been asked in our country several times this year, what do you want for Christmas? What do you want Santa to bring you for Christmas, right? And you probably got a mouthful back too, and that's good. You know, sometimes, maybe sometimes you get something you didn't expect for Christmas, something maybe creative and off the charts. I have to admit, I'm not a very creative gift giver. I wish I was. Unlike some of you, I've seen your posts on Facebook once in a while, and you kind of knock it off, you know, off the charts with this unexpected gift that is just so cool. I wish I was that cool. Last year, one of my gifts to Nina was frying pans, you know? And we had frying pans. This year, well, there's no frying pans, but they're about equal to that, okay? So I'm not really thrilled about my gift to Nina. I'm sorry, Nina. Not so good. And sometimes, you know, even this happens with gifts. We get a gift from someone, and it's not just something we can't, you know, maybe not wanted, but we can't even use it. It's not gonna fit, or we have one already. And we may entertain the option of re-gifting it, right? Have you ever, don't raise your hand if you re-gifted something, okay, but let's face it, none of us are omnipotent. We don't know everything about the other person, and I'm certainly not referring to any gift I've ever gotten from anyone, but in general, you know, it happens. Re-gifting, it could happen. But today I want to talk to you about an unexpected gift as well, okay? I want to talk about God's most unexpected gift, and yet it's the true gift of Christmas, right? It was really an unexpected gift to think that God would do this for us when you really think about it. And here's the beautiful thing about our God. Our God has given us the gift of salvation through his son Jesus because, well, he knows exactly what we need. You know, there's no re-gifting needed here at all. I love hearing the Christmas story. I love watching children hear it or tell it as we watched on the video. I love hearing the story of the angel announcing the birth to Mary and to the shepherds. I love the story of, you know, the manger and the wise men. I love everything about that story. The story of Christmas reminds us of our great need and how God has given us his greatest gift to supply that need, right? But today, and actually tonight as well, our stories in the message time are not going to focus on those bits, okay? The message will be the same, but the story, we won't focus on the parts of the story. I want to read two verses of scripture, very familiar verses. In fact, the first verse is probably, it's usually considered the most well-known verse in all the Bible. Okay, when Bible translators come up with a new translation, they often publish this verse ahead of time, you know, so people could see it, because this verse and the verse that goes along with it, verse 17, really tell why God sent his son at Christmas time, and a lot of other things too. So stand with me, let's read it together. John 3, verses 16 and 17, you'll see it on the screen. Kind of put it up there a little differently because there's really a lot of parallels between these two verses, and you can see that better in two columns. But we're just going to read it through, okay? Verse 16, read it with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. May God bless the reading of his word this morning. Please be seated. I want you to think with me about God's unexpected gift at Christmas. And I have a couple things that you come all out of verse 16, but there's some parallels in verse 17. First of all, I want you to see the motivation behind God's gift. And obviously it's his love, right? God's love is the motivation for him giving us the gift. Here's the truth. God loves you. He loves you just as you are, period. Okay? You don't have to add anything to that. He loves you so much, he wants you to receive this gift of salvation through his son, just the way you are. You don't have to change anything for God to love you. It says, for God so loved the world. And then it goes on. Here's the truth. You don't have to do anything for God to start loving you. You don't have to become a better person. You don't have to be nicer to others. You don't have to do anything. In fact, the Bible says God loves us so much, it says that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, right? His love is the motivation behind his gift. You know, tell you a quick story about what happened in the last few weeks with Carl Fraley. I had met Carl a month or two ago, and I had the opportunity. He's been back and forth in the hospital, and he was in the hospital. First time I met him, I shared the gospel with him. I shared a tract, and he had a lot of questions, and he's a really wonderful person. He said he would read the booklet I gave him, and it didn't go very far. But he had a lot of intellectual kind of questions, you know, and it seemed like every time, you know, we got to something personal, it became intellectual, and I understand that. I'm kind of like that kind of person, too. But, you know, so I just prayed for him. And then a few weeks later, which is just a few weeks ago now, I went back. He was back in the hospital, and I started to share again. It looked like he might not be with us much longer, and I said, can I share the message of Jesus again? And he said, yes. And I did, and I shared how, you know, the Bible says that, you know, the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. And I've shared the gospel many times, and I, at a point, I kept it brief. I said, what do you think about this, Carl, for you? And he said, he started to get intellectual again. He said, I understand what you said, but why did God have to do it that way? You know, why did God have to make it like that? And you know, you can't answer that question. And I basically said that. I said, you know, because God is God and we're not, and this was the way, you know, he's the one who makes the rules. I said, but what he did tell us is that because he is perfectly holy and sinless, and heaven is a perfect, holy, sinless place and we're not, that God had to do something to make it so we can have righteousness to get into heaven. And what God did is he sent his own son to die in our place on the cross. And it's not like I hadn't said that before, but at that point, tears came to his eyes. And I didn't know what was going on, and he said, I asked him, and he said, I can't think of anything harder than for someone to let their child die on purpose. And I'm thinking, yeah. And he said, he must love us so much. And that it was God's love that broke through all the arguments. And at that point, he was ready to receive Christ. The motivation of God's gift is his love. He loves us. But let's keep going, because as we look at this wonderful verse, we're going to go quickly. Notice it talks about the world. The reach of God's love is the world, right? The entire world. Look at verses 16 and 17. You'll find that the phrase "the world" is repeated four different times in these two verses. For God so loved the world, God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved. The world is everyone. We all know that. There's nothing hard to figure out here. But here's the thing. The world is everyone, but the world is you and me. Christmas is like a gigantic Christmas present wrapped in the most beautiful paper you can imagine, and the tag says, "To the world from God, because he loves you." The world talks about the reach of God's gift. It's for everyone. And then it talks about the cost of God's gift, this passage. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son." That's the cost. Only Jesus can pay the price for our sins. Only Jesus can be a sinless substitute to stand in our place and bear the penalty for sin without us having to bear it ourselves. Only Jesus. That's why God sent his son. Only his blood can wash away our sin. And so God gave the very best, his one and only son. I mentioned, don't forget to get your Christmas cards. I got mine. I have one in front of me here. And let's play a little game with it. I'm going to ask you to guess who gave me this card. Okay, it's one of you. They're here today, so don't raise your hand if it's you, okay? I got a lot of nice cards. This one says, "Happy Holidays. Thank you for your spiritual guidance and support you have given us both." And that's a wonderful thought. And that's not why I'm reading it. I'm not reading it to make myself look good. But a lot of you have said some very kind things in cards and letters. And I really do appreciate all of that. But this is why I'm reading it. It's the next thing. FBCM Connecticut's newest member is coming soon. Signed. Anyone know who that's from? Donna does. Who? Nope. But that's exciting too. Anyone else? Would the real writers of the card please stand up? Jesslyn and Chevy. Isn't that cool? Thank you, guys. And congratulations, we're so happy. I want to tell a story about a baby. That's why I started with that. I just thought it fit so well. So I went in, not your baby, but hope we can all relate to this. A young couple was having their very first baby, just like they are, and it was right around Christmas, and it was a boy, okay? He was the first grandchild in the family. The birth had just happened. And very soon after the birth, of course, the new father was in the room, and he ran out of the room, and he got on his phone, and he called his mother, who was in another town, and he was telling his mother, all excited about her new grandson, you know, his name and how long, you know, how much he weighed, 10 fingers, 10 toes, you know, all that stuff. And he just needed to tell it all. He was excited. And his mother listened intently. And then he said, "Hey, Mom, I need to get back in the room with my son and my wife." And she said, "Son, before I let you go, I just want to tell you two things," she said. And his mother said to him, "Son, today, for the first time, you know how much I love you. Because until you have a child of your own, you really don't know how much your mom and your dad love you." And then she said, "And today, you know, in a deeper way than ever before," she said, "how much God loves you. Because think about how much you already love your son, and he gave his one and only son for you." The baby born in Bethlehem, the baby named Jesus, the baby whom the angels adored and the shepherds came and worshiped and proclaimed, this baby was born to die. He was given sacrificially by God because God knew that was the only price that could pay for your sin and mine. That's the cost. But let's move on. The Bible also talks about the receiving of the gift. Here's how you receive it. It says, "Whoever believes." It says, "So that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life." All you have to do is believe in Jesus and the way the Bible says to believe in him, and you receive from God the gift of eternal life. Oh, it's a wonderful story. We tell it all the time. I've explained this many ways and many, many times over and over the years to people of all ages. I hope you have too. To children and all the way up to aging adults who want to know how to get forgiveness and how to get the new life that only Jesus came to give. And there's no clearer way to me to explain that than to tell them about the gift, right? And some of you have heard me tell you about the gift. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ. It's a gift. The only thing we do to get a gift is to receive it, right? That's what happens around the tree tomorrow morning for many of us, or maybe tonight, I don't know. There's a gift, and that gift has your name on it, and it's under the tree. It was purchased by someone else for you, maybe at a high cost, I don't know, that's not important, but it was purchased by them, and it may have cost them a great deal. He or she put your name on the box and wrapped it up, and it's there. They paid it all. What's left to do? There's nothing left to do but to receive it. To take the gift and open it, and it's yours. Okay. But if you leave it there, if you leave it under the tree, if you never take it, it never really becomes yours. What's simpler than that? Believing in Jesus is the way you receive him and his gift of eternal life. I'm going to get a glass. Drink of water. You believe that he died in your place to pay for your sins, and he rose in victory over sin, and you put your faith in what he did for you, and the Bible says you receive the gift of eternal life. It's amazing. But you know, sadly, some won't receive it. Why? Well, I think sometimes people believe they have to pay for the gift, that it's not free. Okay? So let's try this tomorrow morning, okay? Tomorrow morning, pull out your wallet when you're opening your gift from your grandmother or your aunt or your uncle or whoever it is, your parents, and say, "Grandmother, uncle, aunt, this gift is so nice. It's so nice that you got it for me, but I can't let you pay for it. How much do I owe you?" No way is that going to happen, right? They would be offended that you would do that. They gave it out of love, and to pay for it is not to realize how much they love you. God loves you that much. No, we receive the greatest and the most unexpected gift, the most undeserved gift ever given when we put our faith and trust and believe in Jesus Christ, who saved us from our brokenness and our sin and gives us the free gift of eternal life. Hallelujah. So great, isn't it? The Bible talks about receiving God's gift. And then the Bible talks about the goal of God's gift. And that's simply eternal life. Eternal life. That's God's goal for you. If you would believe and trust in Jesus, you receive God's gift, which is Jesus, and you receive eternal life in Jesus, the gift of eternity with God. That's what that means. I want to go back to Ecclesiastes. You don't have to turn there. We'll put it on the screen. It says, "Yet God has made everything beautiful for its own time. He has planted eternity in the human heart." The Bible says that God has set eternity in the heart of the human heart. In every human soul, that means there's a God-given awareness and hunger that there's something more, you know, something that we long for, something that we can't experience in this world, but there's a longing for it. God planted that seed, and you know, we see it in so many ways, even in the most remote cultures or tribes on our planet, there is found this universal sense that death is not the end, a belief in some sort of afterlife. Some have suggested that this hunger that we have inside, this belief of eternity, is what separates us from the rest of God's creatures that he created. you know, that makes human beings different. It's what it means to be made in the image of God, is to have this heavenward bent. Because God is eternal, we who are created in his image have a longing to reconnect with the eternal. You know, this verse 11 makes more sense when you see it in a little bit of the context. So I'm just going to go back for just a minute or two and draw out the context of Ecclesiastes 3. It'll help us to understand it. The chapter starts in the now, not in heaven, not in eternity, but in the now. In verse 1, it says, there is a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven. Now, okay? The next 7 verses list a series of now contrasts. You know, I actually first learned this part of the Bible from the birds in the 60s, rock group who sang a song about this. And this is way before I became a Christian, and I even opened the Bible to read it, but I knew this part from the song, okay? As it talks about, there's a time for everything under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to love and hate, scatter and gather, tear and mend, weep and laugh. There's a time to every purpose under heaven. And then comes verse 11, right after that, which begins, he made everything beautiful in its time. In other words, life is composed of these opposite experiences in balance. God has appointed each to its season. Each season is considered as a part of the whole. Seasons come and seasons go, don't they? But the question of Ecclesiastes, does anything in this life truly satisfy? And the answer in Ecclesiastes is no, it doesn't. All is vanity, it says. It all ends echoing that famous Rolling Stones line. I can't get no satisfaction. I had my head in the 60s, and so I was preparing this, and that one came up in my mind too, but that's kind of what Ecclesiastes says. You can't get satisfaction here. However, through all the ups and downs of life, we know there's something beyond this life, past this life. We've a divinely implanted awareness that the soul lives forever. This world is not our home. It doesn't take a wise person to know that people long for something more than this earth. You know, when we see pain, we yearn for comfort. When we see hunger, we question why. There's senseless deaths, endless tears, needless loss. The human heart has an innate desire for more, for God, for eternity, where time will be no more, and we'll be with him. Psychoanalyst Gerald May writes in his book, he says, after 20 years of listening to the yearnings of people's hearts, I am convinced that all human beings, have an inborn desire for God. Whether we are consciously religious or not, this desire is our deepest longing and our most precious treasure. And the wonderful news of Christmas is that the goal of the gift of Christmas is eternal life. It's eternity. It's the gift of Jesus. It's believing in him. And then we're firmly connected to that eternal, everlasting life with God. Well, there you have it. We've looked at the motivation of God's gift, love. The reach is the world. The cost of God's gift, his dear son, the receiving of God's gift by believing, by trusting in what he did for us, and the goal to receive eternal life. As we close, and we're going to close, Paul, if you're coming up, you can start coming. This Christmas, you may choose, if you've not already done so, you may choose to spend eternity with him. Eternal life is a gift that he actually planned out for you. He entered this world in time and space 2,000 plus years ago to make that possible, to give it to you as a free gift. You will live, here's the thing, you will live eternally somewhere. That's what the Bible teaches. The Bible calls when we live with God eternal life. That's what John 3:16 says. But living without God is also eternal, but it's called eternal death or perishing, as it does mention in that verse. You have a choice. And now that I told you, you know that perishing is only because you refuse to take a free gift, to receive the free gift of God in Jesus Christ. So I just encourage you, don't do that. Why would you do that? Right now, if you're not sure, receive the gift of God in Christ. Trust him as your Savior. And you can do that through talking to him. Just, he's here. Just ask him. God, I want this. You did it for me. I don't have to do anything to get ready. You told me that. I don't know why that is, but it's true. I want this gift. So here's a prayer. You could pray it like this. You could say, Dear God, thank you for the ultimate Christmas gift. Thank you for loving me and sending your son Jesus to pay the cost for my sin. I am placing all my trust and faith in him. Now, Lord, today, I'm doing that. Jesus, thank you for your forgiveness. Help me to know you and live for you. Amen. Hope you pray that prayer if you needed it. I hope you mean that prayer. If you did, God's faithful to his promise. He receives you as you receive him. God is good, isn't he? The gift of Christmas. Let's stand together as we close. And Paul's going to lead us in our closing song. Rick Murphy's going to come and stand in the front with me. If you'd like prayer, you can go to me or Rick. We're going to start doing that each week. At least one of the deacons is going to come up and join me in the front. And just want to encourage you to don't leave this place if you just need to do some business with God in prayer. We'd love to help you with that. If you made a commitment of faith in Jesus, maybe today or recently, come and say that today to me. I would love to just know that and share it with the congregation so you can have people supporting you and praying for you. If you need to be baptized, you come up. If you need to, if joining this church is your next step in being faithful to God, then you come. I'd love to receive you. Rick would love to receive you. Let's sing and respond verse to the two. Lord. Paul?
Born thy people to deliver, born a child and yet a king, born to reign in us forever, now a gracious kingdom bring.
Thank you for being part of the service today. And as I dismiss you, I remind you tonight, 6 o'clock, get here a little early if you can. We're going to start right on time so we can end on time as well. And I just pray God will bless you today and bless your Christmas. If you can't come back tonight, we just wish you a very happy, holy, and joyous Christmas. God bless you. You are dismissed.